Here we are in Cambridge for this week's Question Time. And welcome to you listening, watching, to our audience here, and of course to our distinguished panel, the Conservative former Chancellor, among many other Cabinet posts he held, Ken Clark, Labour's newly appointed Shadow Leader of the House of Commons, Chris Bryant, the former Finance Minister of Greece in the Syriza government, who describes himself as an unapologetic Marxist, Yanis Varoufakis, the Deputy Chairman of UKIP, Suzanne Evans, and the columnist and broadcaster, Julia Hartley Brewer. And as ever, if you want to text or tweet our hashtag, you know, BBCQT, you can follow us at BBC Question Time. You can text comments to 83981, press the red button and stand back. Let's have our first question from Jacqueline Underdown, please.
Should we allow more refugees into the UK than we can cope with, given the housing crisis and the strains on our public services?
Suzanne Evans.
The short answer is no. I would be the first to say that, of course, we've got to help refugees, not least given our track record, unfortunately, in causing or at least contributing to instability in some of the countries that these refugees are coming from. But we need to make a distinction between refugees and migrants. And unfortunately, in a lot of the coverage that we've had about this crisis, that distinction hasn't been made adequately enough. We know that only one in five are actually coming from Syria. We know that many others are clearly economic migrants who are coming from countries where they are not unsafe, and that they have arrived in countries where they are safe, yet they seem to want to keep going on and on to Germany, perhaps to come to Britain, or to go to a country of choice. Now, I fully support, actually, David Cameron's bid to take 20,000 refugees. I think that's fair, and I think he's absolutely right to take them from the camps, which are run by the United Nations High Commission for Refugees, so we know these people are being processed properly. And, of course, some of the first people have already arrived this week. But from a point of view of our national security, I think we have to be very careful. We know that Islamic State is infiltrating some of the people who are coming across on the boats. And we also have to, I think, to be fair to the people who are on our housing waiting lists, which are getting longer and longer. And your question, you know, you put it very well. Should we take more than we can cope with? Absolutely not.
So your view is 20,000, that's it?
Well, I think 20,000, it's going to be over a five-year period. My worry is that the way that the European Union is playing this, and at the moment we have an opt-out from taking the 120,000 that the other EU member states in Schengen have been asked to take this week, my worry is that we might not be able to opt out for that for very long. And already we can hear the EU dictatorial bureaucrats talking, well, David Cameron, if you want to renegotiate the terms of our EU membership, you must take
all
more
right.
refugees.
All
We're
right.
being blackmailed by the EU once again.
Yanis Varoufakis.
Well, let me begin by saying that the answer to the question is exactly the opposite. Firstly... let me remind you, ladies and gentlemen, that we're all migrants. And we're all economic migrants. I believe that, if I believe my anthropologist friends, we are all Africans, actually, who came to these parts of the world.
It was a long time ago.
A long time ago. But the notion that at the time, when there are tens of thousands of desperate refugees being washed up in the shores of Greece and Italy, when there are 3.1 million refugees from that particular conflict in Jordan, in Turkey, in Lebanon, and that these poor countries have opened their doors to these refugees and they've welcomed them, they've sheltered them, they feed them, they make sure that they have water to drink. To have this discussion in Cambridge today on whether there will be 10 or 20,000 people who are let in, to have this moral panic because there are a few wretched souls on the other side of the channel in Calais, this is not putting in good stead this country. This country deserves a lot better.
Is your view that... as you said, we're talking about millions of people. Is your view there should be a completely open-door policy, that they should be able to go to any country?
That's the logical answer.
I have a tendency to say that I think that borders are an absurdity looked at from space.
Yanis.
But we should have a robust debate on precisely the mechanics of dealing with this humanitarian crisis.
All right, well, it begins here.
To simply conjure up ridiculously, pathetically low numbers, for a start, we are running the risk of turning Mrs. Merkel into the moral maiden.
All right. Ken Clark.
Well, to answer the question is, I think we're going to have to take as many as we can cope with. You obviously can't take the world's poor, but there's a mass migration going on around the world. Same thing's happening in the Americas, same thing's happening in Asia, and we've been taken by surprise by it. But we should also take it quite apart from the EU question. People are coming from desperate countries into Europe. They're heading for Germany and Sweden. After that, Britain's quite a popular destination. The idea they come because we're in the EU, and somehow they wouldn't want to come if we weren't in the EU, and it's all something to do with the EU that this has all happened,
is frankly a total irrelevance. Angela Merkel said...
If it's an irrelevance, let's leave it. Is 20,000 the right figure, which is the figure over the next 5 years?
20,000 is a good start, and they're being let in an ordered fashion. They're being identified as vulnerable people, and they're being taken from dreadful camps in Jordan and Lebanon. And what the whole of Europe, we could need a Europe-wide agreement. Firstly, how we get under control and on top of this and cope with it sensibly, and then how we sort out the genuine refugees from people who've joined the flood from other countries like Albania or Pakistan because they think that suddenly they have the prospect of a job here, then how we deal in a civilised fashion, in a more orderly fashion, with the ones coming in.
You haven't answered the question which Jacqueline asked, which was, should we allow more in? She says because
we may have to, because I think this is going to be a problem for the next 10 or 20 years.
Right.
I think we're only seeing it beginning. It's going to be very difficult to stop. You've got to stop it being a race across Europe for the most courageous and the fittest to see how far they could get. You've got to have some place where you can accommodate them in civilized circumstances whilst you actually process them and then decide how you're going to house some, where you're going to put them, and how you're going to get the ones.
We'll talk about whether it's possible to do that. The woman up there at the back.
In a wider sense, can we ask why it's a European question at all? What is the rest, I mean, aside from Turkey taking in 2 million refugees, what is the rest of the world doing? Aside from the desperate situation today during the Hajj, Saudi Arabia has 2 million tents that are already plumbed, they're air-conditioned. Why aren't some of these leaders of these major Islamic countries going, why don't we help out?
Chris Bryant.
I think you make an absolutely vital point. And some of the richest countries in the world are doing absolutely nothing, and they should be getting off their backsides and helping because, I mean, I get quite upset when I hear people talk about people as if they're trying to break all the rules and they're just doing it because they feel like it. Who on earth in their right mind would leave their home with their 2-year-old, 3-year-old, 4-year-old children and cross dangerous seas, cross miles and miles across a continent if they weren't the only people who would do that were people who absolutely had to because they had no alternative to save their children's lives and their own. So I think, I'm sorry, Jacqueline, I disagree with the premise of your question because you said, should we take more than we can cope with? Of course we shouldn't take more than we can cope with, but I think we can cope with more than we are taking at the moment. And I think this country's heart is big enough to cope with more.
In the First World War,
we took many thousands more than we're considering now from Belgium, and they all went back after the First World War when their country was made safe. And that was when many millions of people had died on the fields of Flanders.
So what do you say, Chris?
Hold on a second, I'll come to you, Jacqueline, and I'll come back to you. Okay. Yes,
but we've got to help these poor people, but they're risking their lives to go over the water and, they're landing in a safe country. But why do they still want to get to, you know, other.
Well, they want,
they want to live.
I think they want to come to a country like this country because they'll be safe,
soft.
Because we have the rule of law, because everyone is treated equally under the law.
And frankly,
because we're one of the richest countries in the world, and we should be ashamed of ourselves when we don't open our arms.
Julia, how to do it.
Julia, very briefly, because you asked me something about whether Greece has the rule of law, let me tell you that after the Iron Curtain collapsed, a country of 10 million people took in 1.5 million people. Yep. So we have a sterling record of opening our doors.
Julia.
Jacqueline asked, should we allow more refugees to come than we can cope with? The answer is clearly no, but the question is how many can we cope with? Sure. And that is the big issue. Probably more than 20,000 over 5 years, realistically, yes. We could probably, if we needed to, we could probably take another 20,000, another 100,000, maybe a million, maybe 2 million, maybe 10 million. There are 10 million displaced Syrians within Syria, 4 million who've left the country. Why don't we take them all? We can afford it. We're a wealthy country. But we're not going to, and neither is the rest of Europe going to. There are roughly 5 billion people on the planet who are not as wealthy as your average European. Shall we take them as well? The reality is, Europe, I'm sorry to say, as much as I want us to be a safe haven for people in desperate need seeking asylum, as we were Jews fleeing Nazism and other people over the years, we cannot be the answer, the solution to this problem, because this problem is bigger than that. We cannot have every single person who wants to live in a better country, have more chances of jobs and a nicer home, coming to our country.
I didn't interrupt you.
The key issue here is, there was a quote from the European Council President, Donald Tusk, who said, "The greatest tide of refugees and migrants is yet to come." We've got to get to grips with the fact we are not talking about tens of thousands. We are talking about tens of millions. And the reason they are getting in boats and trying to come to Europe is because Germany and other countries said, "Come on in, you're welcome."
Oh, so that's
the
problem.
They were living
the problem
in
is
Jordan
that Germany
and Turkey
did the right
for three
thing,
years.
Suddenly doing the right thing
is
the cause of the problem.
Germany has a demographic time bomb. Yannis, we don't. You make a
distinction, which many people are making, between people who are fleeing in terror for their lives and people who are searching for a better economic system to live under, where they can prosper better than they could.
Of course I make the distinction, but at the same time I recognise that the distinction is rather blurred in many occasions, because starving to death due to lack of economic opportunity...
They're not starving to death.
Well, some people are.
They're not people
some
in Syria.
People
in
Canada.
Julia, listen, panel, you've got to let each person have a say one at a time. Otherwise, our audience here,
with migrants from Africa,
can't hear what's being said.
Who migrated to Greece under incredible circumstances because their kids were starving to death. I cannot easily say that these people are undeserving, whereas others are deserving because they were shot at. Right. You may make this distinction, but I'm not going to follow you.
A member of the audience, you up there, sir, in the third row.
I agree with most of what Mr. Varoufakis is saying, but surely be more effective to use our resources to solve the conflict in Syria rather than taking
in
refugees, because the refugee crisis is only a consequence of the conflict, and only by solving the conflict can we solve the whole problem
altogether. How would you solve the conflict
in
Syria?
I think democratically it's probably the best way forward. However, over the past few years, not a lot has been done over the Syrian conflict, right. And it's only now that ISIS have come up that countries like America and the UK are actually starting to get involved, because they see that ISIS is actually a threat to them, whereas before it didn't involve them whatsoever.
The woman up there at the right.
Well, the UK is probably one of the most densely populated countries in the whole of the EU. It's probably twice as densely populated as the Eastern European countries that have refused to take any immigrants into the country, and it's certainly much more heavily populated than France. I think probably not quite twice, but surely it should be done on the basis of resources. I mean, our NHS is suffering. Everything. We've got people starving in this country. We have people using food banks. We can be looking at countries that are sparsely populated and take that into account.
All right. And you, sir, the spectacles, no? You don't want to speak. I'll come to you in the second row here, then I'll go back to the panel. Yes, you.
I'd just like to counter the lady's point. She said that Eastern European countries are really densely populated, which is true. but they're countries that aren't willing to accept the migrants. Why would we force such desperate people to go to places where they're going to be victimized, they're going to be put in places they don't want to be in, where people don't want them? Why don't we take them somewhere here where we saw the march, people want to help, where in Eastern European countries, very non-secular countries, very Christian countries, don't want such a Muslim demographic? Why don't we allow them into a country opening its arms?
Suzanne Evans, what's your reply to him?
Well, actually, I think you might think that, but every poll that's been done of the general public actually suggests that we think we're doing enough already. Yep. Last year, 558,000 migrants came to this country. It's not as though we're not unwelcoming, and it's not as though we're not taking enough already. And what I'd like to say to Chris and Yanis, really, is we've got 9,000 people sleeping rough on our streets in this country. As the lady up there said, we've got over 500,000 people using food banks. You know, NHS waiting lists are at their absolute peak, highest ever. We're having to make welfare cuts, apparently, because we're in such dire straits in terms of our economy. And I'd like to say, you know what austerity is like, Yanis. You know what austerity is like. Would you really see Britain brought back to that level? Would you? Would you? Do you think that Greece and the problems that Greece is having now, with thousands, tens of thousands of refugees turning up on its doorstep every day, that's not helping the situation in Greece, is it? You must know that.
All right, Suzanne, you made the point.
You're assuming that migrants are coming in to steal jobs.
No, I'm not.
Migrants boost economic growth in the long run.
Not what
the United States of America would not have been a major force today if they built borders in the 19th century, preventing economic migrants from walking
in. And if you see
a migrant in the NHS, it's likely to be somebody who's treating you, not being treated.
I'll take one more point from the woman over there, but I want to then move on, because we've had a quarter of the programme. We've got many more questions.
It's a huge problem.
We won't solve it in one edition of question time, I can tell you.
Ms. Evans said that 500,000 people are coming into the country. How many people are leaving the country?
Net migration.
I work for the NHS, and I know for a fact that migrants have nothing to do with the waiting lists.
Exactly. OK, right, I'm going to stop this. All right. We're going to move on. All right, Suzanne, you've had your say.
I really think we've generated more heat than light. It's an enormous subject, multifaceted. As somebody said, it starts with how do you tackle the problems of Syria, Iraq, Eritrea, Somalia. Now, that'll take us all evening. Where do you put people when they come out? How do you process them? How do you calculate who can cope? That's going to be what we mustn't reduce it to is everybody getting panicked and angry and saying, why don't they go to other countries? We took 30,000 East African Asians into this country, and like the other migrants we've received, they actually make a very positive contribution to our economy. But it requires rational discussion, organization, international agreement, which will take time, and then we will still find it's an enormous problem. But you combine humanitarian instincts, which are uppermost in this country, with the practicalities. Mm-hmm. And at the moment, we're beginning to do that, and we've got to work with the other 27 members of the European Union in the first place to decide how actually we're going to cope stop arguing with each other about exactly how we might shove some more back to Greece.
Now, before we go on to our second question tonight, a reminder where we're going to be next. Next week we're in Cardiff. The week after that, Leicester. And that's how to apply. I'll give those details later on in the programme. Oliver Turner's question, please.
Does Britain need an alternative to austerity?
Does Britain need an alternative to austerity? All right, Yanis Varoufakis. I wonder what you'll say.
Well, I don't believe that we need an alternative to austerity, because austerity is not an option. And indeed, I'm going to give a compliment to George Osborne and to the Tory government. He's going to create some consternation, I think, in the Tory party. He hasn't really practiced austerity. He's talked about austerity. He did a little bit of it. And then it didn't work. He killed off this nascent recovery after 2009 with a little bit of austerity he did, and he stopped it. And indeed, I can assure you that in discussions I have with good friends of mine in the Tory party, they have been very supportive to us here in Greece and to me personally in our struggle to end austerity in Greece, because they said to me, well, we are the party that has this natural proclivity towards belt tightening during bad times, but we can see that what they did to you, we had 18 times more austerity than George Osborne practiced, and the result was that we lost a quarter of our national income and we ended up in a black hole.
So, Labour's got it all wrong.
So it's not
they?
A question.
Jeremy Corbyn's wrong.
I mean, we
haven't really got austerity at all. There's no problem.
I said there was a little bit of austerity in the grand scheme of things.
Bit.
The problem with austerity is that it's being used as a narrative in order to conduct a class war. And by that, what I mean, and let me give you a very simple example. In Britain today, when you have the lowest percentage of public spending as a proportion of national income for the last 70 years, to be talking about reducing the state further, when effectively what you're doing is you're reducing taxes like inheritance tax, and at the same time you're cutting benefits, that's class war in the state in which Britain fights.
All right, Ken Clark. Class war.
Well, I thought you had it started well. I mean, austerity is a political cliche word now. I actually obviously don't agree with Yanis. I believe in free market economics with a social conscience. And
so do I.
Good free market economics with a political conscience.
Yes.
Mr. Marx didn't quite get there.
Well, I am an erratic Marxist, not an unapologetic Marxist.
I see, you're a modern Marxist. But
erratic,
we're moving in the right direction,
Yanis. I'm an inconsistent Marxist.
But anyway, on the serious point, you cannot have the kind of prosperous economy that our children, our grandchildren need unless you combine good, enterprising economic policy with well-managed public finances. That's what the idea that you can somehow run up debt on the scale that all the Western democracies did, run annual deficits on the scale all the democracies did, and either borrow it ad nauseam from other countries at the expense eventually of their taxpayers if you default, or somehow just print it and spend it on worthwhile things, would be marvellous if it worked. I mean, if you could just print the money and spend it on people, I'd sign up to that.
But I think Yanis
will accept it doesn't work.
But what about what you said about our economy? I just quote you. Our productivity performance is dreadful. Our investment performance is poor. Trade and export dismal, and we have an appalling current account deficit.
Yeah.
And that's under a Tory government who's practicing the policies that you now say are the right policies to be pursuing.
I do like the political debate to move on.
Right?
It's part of my say. I also said other things. I did say.
Well, you may have said lots of other things. You did say those.
It's very selective. I actually did.
It's
I
not
think
selective,
in the same
it's a
speech,
whole sentence.
I agree with that. It was part of the point I was making. That little snippet is selective. I mean, it's not confined to you. We are part way to sorting out the worst financial crisis in the lifetime anyone in this room, and coming out of our longest and deepest recession since the war. And you have to understand we're doing quite well. We're doing better than pretty any other Western economy, with the possible exception of Ireland's growing faster than us, that America's
right.
doing quite well. But a precondition to tackling all those problems is healthy public finances. If you just incur annual deficits, but giving in to political pressure, just incur ever mounting debt, it will destroy the other things. But George Osborne is halfway through a task, and the first thing to do is to stop 80% debt to GDP ratio rising. And until he's got on top of that, he won't have the kind of economy our children and grandchildren want, and it's got to be combined with actually getting the public finances back to common
right.
sense.
I think we get the point, Ken. Thank you very much. And can you, if you can tell us Perhaps you can't. Where does Labour stand on this?
you're into printing money, aren't you, Chris?
Well, listen, you've been printing money for years and just giving it to bankers. Look.
I think it's not that started under Labour.
Let him speak.
One at a time, please. Well, I'm trying to speak now.
I did notice.
Could you just be quiet?
I did notice.
It's not just about the kind of economy we want to have, it's the kind of society and the kind of country that we want to have. And I think when we make false economies, so local authorities in this country have to close every swimming pool and every library because they're facing £70 million worth of cuts every year or whatever. The problem is we are making a false economy in the long run. And George Osborne, I know he's got a plan. He's got a plan to get himself into Downing Street in 2020. He's got a plan which is to set a deliberate surplus by the end of this parliament. Now, I think that means he's going to make unnecessary cuts which make it more difficult for us to prosper as a country. We should be investing in skills so that we can bridge that productivity gap that we've got. We've got a terrible productivity problem in this country and it's getting worse. We should be making sure that we are investing in those areas of the economy which are growing, like the creative industries. Or here in Cambridge, you have great scientific innovations, but how often is it possible actually to get those to market so that we as a country can prosper on the back of them? We need investment in those businesses and in those creative industries so that we can prosper. And my anxiety is that what the government has done ever since 2010 is they really came in with a project to cut the size of the state. But let me just give you one example. If you, at the moment, we have a massive problem in mental health services. The waiting lists for getting to mental health services now 3, 4, 5, 6 months. That is counterproductive because it means that people don't get back into work. That's where you need a strong state to be able to support people so that we can all prosper.
Oliver Turner.
I think, obviously, the state does have a role to play, but as Ken said, when the debt-to-GDP ratio is at 80%, which doesn't include the vast amount of sort of so-called debt that is built up in the pension liabilities that's somewhat uncounted, I think it's pretty dangerous to argue we should sort of be slowing the pace of austerity or taking it sort of with some idea that because these things happened quite a long time ago now, that they're somehow resolved. They're absolutely not. The one part of government spending that's not really being touched, and I'm sure this will offend a lot of people, is the amount of pensions being kept for the older generations, which, you know, is all well and good because they vote a lot, but the younger generations are kind of getting screwed here by some of these the sort of willingness to cut only to the services where people aren't really voting, and concentrating sort of the money or that's available on the sort of those people who actually turn up to elections.
Okay, and. I'll get the person up there on the left-hand side. Yes, you.
Well, the Conservatives just seized upon the financial crash, which was nothing to do with Labour's management of the economy. Labour managed the economy better than the Conservatives. The deficit.
Sorry,
has...
Labour managed the economy better than the Conservatives.
The Conservatives, yes. And it's just a complete myth that we have the way to grow our economy and have fiscal responsibility is just by cutting and cutting and cutting. The Tories supported Labour spending plans. Yep. The only reason that national debt became a problem was because the banking system crashed.
Okay. Julia Hartley-Brewer, do you want to pick up that point?
Look, I know, a plague on all their houses. Everyone conspired with the deregulation of the markets and allowed that to happen and us to bail them out without enough controls on what the banks did next to make sure we got our money back. It was a ridiculous way to do it. But the question was very clear. It was, you know, does Britain need an alternative to austerity? This question was basically put to the British electorate back in May and the answer was resounding no. There was a statistic I discovered a few years ago that I was blown away by. When we talk about austerity and cutting back our welfare, a third of working age people in Britain, not pensioners, a third of working age people in Britain are relying on state benefits for more than half of their income. Now, I believe in the welfare state. I'm the daughter of an NHS GP. I love the welfare. I love that we are a civilised country where people who are disabled or people who have fallen on hard times or are sick get help from our state. And in some areas, I think the Conservative government's doing the wrong thing, cutting some of those benefits. But But fundamentally, the welfare state was supposed to be for people in need, not people who quite wanted a little bit of extra cash from their tax credits and the like. We have to roll back the state. It's no longer a safety net. It's a big, snuggly, king-sized duvet that is wrapping up people and is actually... Well, it's actually preventing people from going out and getting jobs and living on their own. It is basically a subsidy to landlords for high rents. It's a subsidy to employers who don't pay reasonable wages. And we need to roll back the state and we need to let the market work and we need to make sure that we are not subsidising landlords and the state like that. Thank you.
Suzanne, I'll come to you. I just want to put a question to Yanis, though, because you said you praised George Osborne, and then you said what was happening was actually a reconstruction of the class system. It was benefiting the rich, not the poor. Are you saying, in effect, that within the measures that the Chancellor can take, he should stick to the same deficit reduction, but just use different methods to achieve it?
I believe there is a lot of rhetoric about deficit reduction. The reality is not deficit reduction. What we have. Look, I will agree utterly with Ken Clark that there are two pillars of a successful social economy. One is healthy public finances, and the other is investment.
Yeah.
Right? So you can have a boisterous private sector. I think that we can agree on that. The disagreement concerns what you do within a decent budget, a healthy budget. You can cut it by reducing the privileges of the rich, by increasing, for instance, inheritance tax instead of reducing it, or you can cut it by reducing tax credits for the poor. Now, that's a decision you can make within the realm of healthy public finances. On investment, the notion that the Bank of England prints mountains of money, purchases paper assets in the City of London, bolsters the banks, which it had to do, I understand it had to do it, but that money somehow will trickle down to investment in productive capacity, that is a fantasy. And this is where an alternative form of QE would be something that we should be discussing. And I don't think that this should boil down to ideology. Milton Friedman, Bernd Bernanke, who are on the side of politics that the Tory party is, would want to have this discussion. We have mishandled QE in Britain, in the United States. We are doing it very badly in the European Union, in the Eurozone now. We should have, as Ken said before, a little bit more light than heat on these matters.
All right. Suzanne.
Well, I don't agree with Yanis on George Osborne. I'd like to remind everyone that he has nearly doubled our national debt, despite the huge amount of austerity that you've seen. And the question do we need an alternative? Well, there is an alternative. We need to cut back massively on waste in the public sector, on public spending. And when I wrote UKIP's manifesto, we found all sorts of money, not least £12 billion for the NHS, by cutting back on that waste. You know, our EU membership, £55 million a day, that could go to start with. The amount of vanity projects it shores up. Our foreign aid budget, now, of course, we all want to help people overseas, but people at home here needs that money too. And we've seen in the revelations in Lord Ashcroft's book, in fact, today, why do we have this arbitrary 0.7% of GNI given in foreign aid? Well, allegedly, David Cameron said it's to get the aid agencies off his back. The Barnett formula, too much money going up to Scotland, not enough staying in England and in Wales. HS2, a vanity project, white elephant that could go. That would save around 70
billion.
Can I give
you one reason why foreign aid should remain?
Government, and even at just at local government level, and I've been a councillor myself, I've seen a huge amount of waste. And Chris said, you know, people have to shut libraries. Well, actually, you don't. If you look at procurement, if you look at efficiency, a lot of this is actually political posturing, I think, by the Labour Party, who try and say, oh, government cuts, and actually it's an excuse for their poor spending decisions.
All right, hold on. I'll come to you, Chris. Let me just hear from one or two members of our audience, you, sir, and then I'll come to you in the white shirt there.
Okay, I think politicians spend so much time arguing amongst themselves about the problem. Economics is really simple. I've got £10 in my pocket. If I go out and buy 3 pints of beer in Cambridge, I'm probably borrowing money. If I carry on doing that, then I'm going to run out of money and I'm going to go bust. It's not difficult, guys. Just sit down, work out what the country needs to do and work collectively together.
Because the country does not operate as your budget does.
We have a budget.
But why not? Why not? Why not?
In the country, total expenditure equals total income. in your life, you have a wonderful independence between your expenses and your income. So when you cut down on your expenses, your income doesn't cut. It's not cut. But for the country as a whole, if the country as a whole goes into a major savings spree, then its total income is going to come down. So your personal life is not a good model on which to base...
It would all be seven seas under if it were, too. Chris Bryan.
I was talking to a constituent of mine from Treorchy last week, and he was saying to me, he's been out of work for some time, he's just got a job, but it's not an easy job for him to get to physically because there's no public transport. He needs to buy a car. He's got to borrow money to buy a car, but because it's going to be a 0 hours contract, he can't borrow money. That's the kind of problem that people get into in these problems. And the one thing I'd say to Suzanne is, the reason we need a foreign aid budget is so that we can make sure that more refugees can stay in their own countries because their countries have legitimate economies to stay in.
Do you want to come in?
Man in the white shirt, though, is what I do. The man in the white shirt.
But it would also help not invade their countries.
Yes. We didn't invade Syria. How's that working?
Well, right, Iraq and Syria completely won.
Let's get a microphone to him. I'm waiting to hear what he has to say.
Suzanne Evans,
yes.
Why do you blame George Osborne for the size of the national debt?
I don't necessarily.
You've
just
said that
George
he doubled it in his
debt.
Time.
It was
just
Liam
said
Bernard,
that he doubled it.
It was Liam Bernard, the Labour
Party. Until we're in surplus,
Party.
How is it going to decrease? Until we get the deficit into a surplus, how is the national debt going to decrease even £1? So
have
why
I
are
suggested?
You surprised that it's doubled? Of course it's going to double
have
until
I
we're
in surplus.
Have I suggested
that we shouldn't do that? You know, Liam Byrne in the Labour Party was the one that left the note at the Treasury, there's no money left. And I'm sorry, I completely disagree
but
with
George
the lady.
But George Osborne said...
It's as Julia said, a plague on all their houses.
But George Osborne said the deficit would have been gone by 2015. His policy has not worked.
And you predicted there would be a mass unemployment of 3 million, and there isn't, is
you
there?
Go at the pace. Leave the predictions a moment. You in the front row.
Suzanne, how do you think leaving the EU is going to help with the migration crisis or with the funding and business in this country? Secondly, to the panel, if it's about austerity helping our economy, why now that the banks are back on their feet, are we still cutting NHS funding and not doing anything
NHS
back to the banks?
Right. Well,
we
are. NHS funding's going up.
There's a new junior doctors contract that's given a 30% pay cut.
We might come to the NHS in a moment. But I want to move on. I want to just move on to a different topic before we do that. And it's a question from Hassan Mamdani, please.
Is putting a vegan who likens meat eaters to smokers in charge of DEFRA contempt or inspired leadership?
Yes, not actually in charge. She's the shadow environment secretary, one of your colleagues, Kerry McCarthy, who today said meat should be treated in exactly the same way as tobacco, with public campaigns to stop people eating it. Julia.
I have to say, it's a big load of nonsense I've ever heard.
Yeah,
and that's saying something coming from the new shadow cabinet.
Thank you for that.
Gracious exception of Mr. Fryer.
I love you.
Who was once rather amusingly mistaken for my husband. My husband was quite chuffed there. Look, meat doesn't kill people in the same way that every single cigarette does, as Ken Clark would know, having worked for a multinational tobacco company for many years. Every single cigarette is harmful. Every single one. If it was up to me, they'd be illegal. I don't think you'd be allowed to sell products that kill people.
She says it causes suffering to the animals. That's the point.
They're not killing us. No, look. At the end of the day, there is a very, very strong moral argument, the fact that certainly in a country as wealthy as ours, that we are able to pay more for our meat. We should eat less meat just for health reasons for ourselves, but we should pay more for our meat and expect our animals to be kept in better conditions so that they have a happier life. I would absolutely be willing to do that. I don't think we should allow meat to be sold at some of the prices that involve poor treatment of these animals. However, we are omnivores. We are supposed to eat meat. There are some vitamin B complexes we can't get from anything else on the planet. We need to eat meat, and I think this militant veganism, frankly, it's just nonsense.
All right. Well, Chris Bryan, I could just mention the question again. It's whether putting a vegan who likens meat eaters to smokers in charge of DEFRA is it contempt or inspired leadership?
Well, I actually thought that Hassan said putting Putin in charge, and I thought we were doing Russia suddenly for a question. But look, I'm afraid I disagree with Kerry. Kerry is a very close friend of mine, and I love her dearly, but I just disagree with her on this. I think we were absolutely right to bring in the ban on smoking in public places, because there is such a thing as passive smoking, and it does kill people. And I think we're right to be looking at, you know, we've been right to introduce all the different measures about selling of cigarettes so that we're not promoting it as attractive to young people and all the rest of it. And I don't think that any of that applies to meat. I'm not
sure
about...
How much do you agree with each other in the Shadow Cabinet?
Well, we've only had one meeting so far.
How did
we all
go?
Agreed,
how did that go? You all agreed it was a good thing.
We all agreed that everything was very good. And and look.
Did you agree to stay in NATO? Because you were going to be defence shadow, and then you said, I can't be because you're going to leave NATO. And then sitting here last week, your Shadow Chancellor...
McDonald
said, oh, no, we're not leaving NATO. It's difficult to make head or tail of what you are doing at the moment.
Sky told everybody that I turned down the job because Jeremy wasn't prepared to invade Russia.
Yes.
Now, I can confirm that this is completely and utterly untrue, right?
So, No,
I don't want to invade Russia. I mean, I have my problems with... And frankly, the way this government's treated the armed forces, I don't suppose we could invade Alderney. Look, I mean, there is a serious point in here, which Julia actually referred to, which is that we do eat too much red meat, and the fact that we do so does kill us, actually. And the fact that we eat too much meat is not good for us. I'm not sure about this militant omnivorism that you just poured out there, that we are all designed to be omnivores.
Have you checked the state of your teeth are for? They do different jobs, different teeth
yeah,
for different jobs. They're
also quite good for Rice Krispies, but I don't think that means that we were all designed to eat Rice
Krispies. We're not going to start looking at each other's teeth. Ken Clark, now you represented the tobacco industry, still do probably, or you've stopped doing
it? No, I don't really represent
that.
I was a non-executive director of a tobacco company.
Yes. So what's your view about it being...
Well, I took the view on tobacco. I take the view that well-informed adults are free to make their own choice about their lifestyle and the risks they take. The biggest risk I take is, I think, driving my car. I also take a risk. I know I take a risk in smoking my cigars. I smoke my cigars whilst driving my car. So I was, as I said, reckless. I'd love to take up with Chris his latest commitment to increase defence spending above the 2%, which he obviously thinks we've excessively cut back the armed forces. I'd love to know whether his new leader agrees with that. But we, no doubt, the next Shadow Cabinet meeting will resolve this.
Ken, consensual, collective...
To be fair, he probably agrees with as much as you do with Jeremy Corbyn.
I think lots of people would love to attend the Shadow Cabinet. You should sell tickets. Oh, yes. I mean, I think we're all...
No, we don't believe in
Let's
selling
Let's get back
seats.
To the question, out of courtesy to the questioner. I just take the straightforward view that if you look at the human condition, at our anatomy, our jaw, our digestive system, we're plainly omnivores. We always have been. We actually eat meat and we also eat vegetables. And I admire Kerry's view that she's so consumed by her love of animals that she's prepared to go onto a non-meat diet. But I do think it's scientifically and realistically nonsense, and I hope she's got some rather more scientifically, factually based views on the environment
Hassan, what do you think? You've been listening to all this.
Yeah, I do agree with Julia's point that it's about animal husbandry, the way that we choose to buy our food, or we have to make choices about how we buy our food, and we would shop, or we should shop ethically. I think Kerry's confused, or putting a vegan in, giving her this brief, confuses, or she is confusing, her own... Sorry, I'm completely losing my point here.
You haven't lost your point at all. You've made it very clearly. She's confusing her views with the job she's been asked to do.
That's unfair, because I think it's good that we have some people in politics who hold strong views, and that shouldn't prevent them from...
Wrong.
And that shouldn't... Well, you're wrong quite often as well, but I still think you should be able to write for
The
Express.
Yeah.
No, I haven't worked for the Express for 5 years.
Yeah, it's very fair.
Well, I'd love to see a militant vegan become the CEO of Volkswagen. Having said that, as an outsider, because you may have noticed that I'm not from here, I think that it's wonderful that the Labour Party has undergone this transformation, independently of whether you agree with Jeremy Corbyn, particular members of the shadow cabinet, because suddenly now politics is becoming interesting. And it reminds me of a similar transformation that the Tories had when Margaret Thatcher came in. And you will recall, of course, or at least some of you, will recall that when she came in, she was not a representative of the median voter. Her views were considered extreme by even some members of the Conservative Party. And she reinvigorated right-wing politics. And it would be wonderful if Jeremy could do this for left-wing politics. Maybe that will force the Conservative Party to lift its game too and put on a show for us. For us outsiders, that we can enjoy watching.
All right. Susanna.
The fiasco that is Jeremy Corbyn's shadow cabinet, it's going to give us hours of endless entertainment, I think, for many days and weeks to come.
You have a shadow cabinet?
Of course we do.
Yes. Are you in it or out of it at the moment?
I'm in it.
How can I buy a ticket to that one?
Now, I actually don't rule out the idea of a vegan, in theory, becoming a shadow agriculture minister. I think for the very reason that Chris outlined, we've had health secretaries that know sod all about health, we've had education secretaries that know absolutely nothing about education. But this one, she absolutely is committed to the eradication of livestock farming. And so I really don't see how she can even begin to do her job. I feel very strongly about animal welfare. I support compassion in farming. I'm not a farmer's daughter, but I have lots of family who are farmers, and so I spend a lot of my life on farms and working on farms. And some of it's cruel, there's no doubt about it, and we need to stop that, and it's something that needs to be looked at. But I don't think Kerry's the right person to do it.
Okay.
If she wants to be a vegan, she can be. It's her choice, not mine. I don't want to see any of her nanny state policies impacting on me or any of us, in fact.
We have 10 minutes left, and I want to come to another important question, particularly considering where we are. And it's from Fiona Arthur Wallace, please.
Do hospitals being put under special measures for financial reasons show that NHS budget pressures have reached breaking point?
Do NHS hospitals, of course, Addenbrookes in Cambridge yesterday, I think it was announced, was being put under special measures. Does it show that NHS budget pressures have reached breaking point now? You're a former health secretary, Ken Clark. What do you think?
Well, there'll be a judgment made in the public spending round, I'm sure. No government's ever cut spending on the health service, and no government ever will at the moment, because the population's getting older, the medical advances, clinical advances surging forward. There's always been a debate. There's been no health secretary hasn't been told that he should spend more than he's committed to on health. That will be a constant debate. And you have to listen to if it's based on the patient's needs and fulfilling the service. But the fact is, because you're running up an escalator, you have to have a finite budget and there are infinite demands. You do have to concentrate all the time on management, efficiency, actually knowing where you're spending the money, how you're spending it, and not just have these constant pushes for campaigns. There's already a pay claim element coming into the present arguments about NHS spending. And I think at the moment we've combined getting on top of the financial crisis we were talking about, actually improving the sustainability of our economic recovery, and still the health service remains the best in the world.
So why is Addenbrookes one of the most famous hospitals in Britain?
They've always had failing
hospitals. Put under special.
Well, because we have a better inspection system. Jeremy has greatly improved. No. I was health secretary 30 years ago. I closed more hospitals than people had hot dinners, and we had some terrible, terrible hospitals. We had the old workhouses were called geriatric hospitals, and people lived in dreadful conditions. The health service now, successive governments have been in charge, is far, far better than it was 30 years ago.
All right.
You'll always have some areas where they fail, either bad management, mistakes, pressures, the layout of the service is all wrong, hasn't been modernised. There are big things to tackle at the moment, like the combination between hospitals, GPs, care at home. We've got a big community care problem.
All right, Ken,
you have to fight all these things, get the money you can, and spend it.
I think we get the point. Suzanne Evans, UKIP, if I've got it right, is against this inspection system at all.
No.
You want the abolition of it?
No, absolutely not. Don't know where you got that from. But one thing I'd like to say...
In your manifesto, which you wrote.
What? abolition of the CQC?
I take your bet.
We've got to have...
CQC, you want to abolish it?
Part of your waste campaign. Don't.
Discuss it in your shadow cabinet.
All right, anyway.
OK, well... I think we've got to have some kind of inspection programme.
Yeah,
certainly,
we didn't
I think
have
we'd,
one
be,
30 years
we'd be
ago.
Absolutely in well, favour yeah, of a more of an inspection
but
programme
NHS,
that involves
is the NHS
the
budget
lay.
Putting too much pressure on the hospitals? Is that the point? Is the question?
Yes, I think it is. The first thing I'd like to say is actually, although we've got Addenbrookes in special measures, the quality of patient care at Addenbrookes in this inspection was still rated as excellent and very high. And I think that's an absolute credit to the doctors and nurses who are working there, that despite all these pressures, they still manage to do their jobs, and not only that, they do their jobs incredibly well. Part of the reason that the NHS is under so much pressure, I think, is that Ken talked about management and efficiency. Well, that's all very well, but spending on management in the NHS has gone up tenfold since 1997. Money is going into the wrong places. You know, there was 108 million, I think, golden handshakes. 4,000 managers laid off, and then a lot of them re-employed back.
But do you think you can do it? Can you run the NHS with fewer managers?
That's
or
why you
yes, I absolutely think.
Isn't,
I think we
but
can.
But at Addenbrookes, they said they needed better managers.
Well,
more managers.
Better managers.
You don't need more. It's about actually doing management properly. And the fact is, I think all this money that's going into management clearly isn't working, and clearly isn't working in this in this instance. And there's still a huge amount of waste in the NHS, which could be better put into frontline patient care.
OK. There's somebody waving at me consistently. Go on, I'll come to you now, because otherwise you'll...
Thank you. I've got 3 points to make.
No, there's 1 point, if you will.
OK, 1 point on such an important topic. So I'm a medical registrar in geriatric medicine. One of the reasons why Addenbrookes Hospital, and I worked there for 2.5 years, one of the reasons why I was in so much problem was because of debt, because of over-reliance on locums. Now, the new junior doctor contract, which is being forced upon doctors, it will increase locum spending because junior doctors will leave. Now, what this will mean is patient safety will be greatly compromised. There'll be fewer doctors for you to see. You'll have to wait longer for you to see them, and they'll be burnt out. Now, when this will target the female doctors who want to have children, researchers who are researching things like cancer, dementia, heart disease...
All right, I get the point.
Can I just make one final point, please?
What you're saying is the change to the contract for junior doctors is going to lead to
these consequences. If I could just make one final point. When bankers were allowed to keep their bonuses, it was because we could possibly not allow them to leave the country because they were such an asset. Are the staff members of the National Health Service not an asset? This is the start of the dismantlement of the National Health Service. And as junior doctors, we will strike to prevent this from happening. We cannot let this happen. We will not.
So, Chris Bryant, I would ask the applauding audience
Ken. To actually try and find more detail of what is proposed for junior doctors. If the whole spending on the health service debates can be carried away by another BMA pay claim, we are going to get into difficulties.
Can you just let the rest of the panel speak? Because we've only got a few minutes.
Surely.
Chris Bryant. First of all, we shouldn't have wasted £3 billion on an unnecessary and unwarranted top-down reorganisation of the NHS. Secondly, there hasn't been a cut to the NHS budget, but there has been a cut to the NHS and social care budget, and those two have to go together, and that's one of the problems. In the case of Addenbrookes, Suzanne is absolutely right to say that the report said that there was very good quality of care. I have no criticism of the staff, but it said that there weren't enough midwives to provide a safe service for Labour. Not for the Labour Party. That may also be true. And the truth of the matter is, last week, in 3 days, 1,644 junior doctors in this country applied for certificates to be able to go and work elsewhere. The registrar is absolutely right in what he says. These are people who are assets to this country. At the moment, we have a 48% lack of doctors, junior doctors to work in obstetrics, 49% lack of doctors to work in acute care. We have a crisis going on in the NHS, and if the Tory government just keeps on trotting out this argument that they have for the last few years, we will never see it improve.
Okay. Julia.
As someone who spent their childhood with a mum training to be a doctor doing 80-hour weeks, I have every sympathy and very much understand. Look, I agree with all the points about the top-down restructure. We've had permanent revolution in the NHS for many years with no good outcomes. We certainly have had an abject failure of management, an abject failure of planning. You know, in 2010, the Tories and the Lib Dems decided to cut the number of nurses being trained. And, oh, what a surprise, then we had to import a load of nurses at great cost. We've got a lot of problems. However, we also have to remember, as well as the fact that, yes, we're all getting fatter, which is one of the reasons why we've got huge extra burden on the NHS, and it is a personal responsibility of all of us to not become a burden on the NHS so that it is there and the resources are there to help the people who genuinely do need it.
So it's our fault, not the budget.
No, not our fault, but we have a personal responsibility. But this is also, the NHS's problems are also a product of its own success. We are living longer. The average age of someone going into...
Yeah, but we know all that. The question is whether budget pressures...
The average age of someone going into hospital now is over 65.
I know, we know all that. That's commonplace. The point is, are the NHS hospitals put under special measure? That's what Fiona asked. Is it because the NHS budget pressures have made it reach breaking point?
No,
we can't all help growing older.
No, but that's the whole point. That is what it is, but that's where you come down to the issues like social care. A third of hospital admissions, it is thought, are not necessary, because if we had adequate social care and funding of social care, those people wouldn't have to be in hospital.
And this hospital has a £64 million deficit.
And it wouldn't have the awful situation, horrible phrase, of bed blocking, where elderly people can't be discharged to their homes because there isn't the social care.
Yanis Varoufakis.
Well, allow me to look at this issue from the outside, being an outsider. This country has produced precious institutions. The NHS is one, the great university is another. Somewhere along the line, you folks lost your nerve. And you started questioning your own achievements. And this market fetishism entered realms in which it was never meant to be good at. Like, for instance, the NHS or the universities. And we started trying to introduce market solutions where they would never work. They resemble more like Soviet planning with these market indicators and trying to quantify the unquantifiable, which is the result of which, of course, is the loss of quality, both in the universities and in the hospitals. I think you should go back to the great tradition of public service and public services provided by means of hierarchical institutions in which good people dedicated to the task do good stuff without having constantly to top down and quantify everything they're doing, with the managers in the end taking a large part of the cut away from the doctors and from the nurses. Yes.
Okay. I'm afraid there are so many hands up, I shall be garrotted by the audience when I say that the time is up. And we have to stop. I'm sorry. I would that it weren't. Next week we're going to be in Cardiff, and we have Margaret Thatcher's biographer, Charles Moore, on our panel, and Charlotte Church, the singer and left-wing campaigner, both on that panel, alongside the politicians. The week after that we're in Leicester, so if you'd like to come to Cardiff or Leicester, you can apply by going to the website, which is written on the screen there, or call 0330 123 9988. If you're listening to this on 5 Live, the debate continues with question time, extra time. But my thanks to our panel who came here, some all the way from Greece, and to all of you who came to take part in the programme in Cambridge. Until next Thursday from Question Time, good night.
Back after their break, lots to talk about next. Alan Johnson and Jacob Rees-Mogg are on the sofa with guest Jimmy Osmond. It's Andrew Neil with This Week.
We're going into a full race war.
White power!